26 Van Nuys, Carolina. Southeast shit.
It's the Carolina Bay from the Ville to the QC. All my niggas on red. One flow, the bird, Buddy Dude, Utah, Winston, Cliff down, down. This is a home, the streets that I roam. It's been a while. Raised me like the father I never had. I'm still your child.
Hey guys, a belated welcome back to Roundtable Talk, the channel where I dissect, analyse and review the latest releases as well as some old classics. So we're right back at it. One of the big three has finally dropped our full project, hopefully kicking off 2021 with the music releases obviously having slowed over the past year. But yeah, Cole's dropped an actual full body of work and I couldn't not react to it, could I? Obviously Cole only announced this I think a couple of weeks ago, and it's already been a really exciting rollout, maybe just because, you know, there hasn't been a big album release for such a long time, but also the confidence that Cole has shown in, you know, the documentary he released, in the freestyle he released recently, just really is infectious and just gets you really excited for the potential of this body of work. Who, you know, Cole is at an interesting point of his career where he is clearly one of the big three, but hasn't really had an outstanding body of work since Forest Hills Drive, which, you know, way back in 2014, 2015. For me, Friday Night Lights is still for his best, the pinnacle of J. Cole work. I love, you know, his sort of everyman, man of the people kind of vibe, and I'm hoping we get a lot more of that. It's clear from, you know, his features throughout 2018 and 2019, that freestyle that, again, I keep mentioning with the LA Leakers, he's really focused on his delivery, his flows, his cadences, to try and just switch it up, and the progression that he's shown over the past, you know, 5 or so years that he's apparently been working on the off-season is really fantastic, and you can tell that finally, after having collaborated with so many different people within Dreamville, the likes of JID and Baz, who, you know, are known for great flows, but also people like 21 Savage, Offset, Anderson .Paak, and others like them, he's really taken on a new level, especially in terms of melodically, and adding differences of cadence to his flows that really just make his verses more impactful. But his lyrics have also improved too, which is saying a lot when Cole's already been a great lyricist, in my opinion. The documentary, even the name of the project, definitely gave me an impression that Cole really wants to prove himself as a rapper on this album, rather than as a songwriter or as a song maker. And I find that interesting because I don't think Cole the rapper has ever really been questioned. I think it's more about the overall picture, the overall package of his music that's sometimes been lacking, and been able to, you know, get across his more impactful points in a more memorable or in a more engaging, exciting way, dynamic way, I guess probably the best way to put it. So fingers crossed that this album isn't focused too much on just showing off, you know, what I like to call rappity rap tracks, and does have those sort of personal, emotive touches that I personally go to Cole for. As I said, I think him leaning into that sort of everyman side of him, that man of the people, really does allow him to connect with people. I think that's where he's strongest, and I think Cole's probably at his best in those sorts of environments, the likes of, you know, Breakdown from his debut album, from Enchanted, from Before I'm Gone on Friday Night Lights, and just similar tracks like that. And I'm really happy to see that Cole's worked with lots of different producers, in the likes of Timbaland, Boy Wonder, and even having T-Minus as the executive producer on this album. If you've watched any of my early Drake reviews, you'll see that I'm such a massive fan of T-Minus's old sound, and I have liked his work with Cole in more recent years too, so I'm excited to see his sort of guiding hand over this project, and as I said, the inspiration that these collaborators draw out of Cole. But yeah, before I get into it, please do remember to subscribe to the channel, like the video, and follow me on all the social links below. But yeah, let's not waste any more time. Cole has dropped, let's dive into it. First track is called 95 South, and it's produced by Boy Wonder. Let's hear it.
Killer, it's the off season. Let's keep it tall, y'all ain't fucking with my man.
This shit too easy for me now. Nigga Cole been going black since back when CDs was around.
Fair, little appearance from Cameron there. Of course, J. Cole is well-rooted in the New York hip-hop scene, having moved there and pretty much found his way into the rap game while living in New York. But yeah, I'm pretty sure that's something Cameron was like, I really mean it track. potentially why he's also got Cameron on the track as well.
Look how everybody clapping when your 30 song album do a measly 100,000. If I'm betting on myself, then I completely double down. How'd I get up? Dust my clothes off. Sleep is the cousin of death. Bitch, my pen of the paper's lethal. I'm sending them straight to meet
them. Here
we go. The self. Fuck it with Cole, it's bold, but it's impeding on you.
I was a little bit worried because that first verse sounded like standard Cole. Not that it was bad, it's just that, you know, it was one of those old, almost robotic Cole flows. So again, some good bars in there, especially that line about 30 track albums. I could not agree more. And I can't tell you my relief when I saw that this was 12 tracks, 39 minutes. The perfect platform for a concise body of work. And something that, to be fair to J. Cole, he's always been quite consistent with. You look at, obviously, lots of other artists, Drake, who overload their albums with way too much stuff. But anyway, getting off track, that first verse was a little bit like old Cole, but instantly getting into the second verse, he's already switching up the flows, being a bit more inventive. So it's nice to see that he has actually taken that on board.
We seen dilemmas like Nelly and Kelly, the end of the deadliest fashion. My young niggas nutty, they blasting. Bullets be humming like Cuddy, but what are your hoodies, spaghettios splashing?
Huh? Yeah, pretty good intro, pretty commanding, pretty good, pretty aggressive, I guess, as well. Obviously, Cole's talking about the state of the rap game, which he's often done throughout his career, especially on more recent albums. But it's interesting that he includes that, you know, Cameron as a narrator, samples Cameron, and then all samples, I think, Lil Jon towards the end of the track as well. And I guess that kind of locates Cole's mindset or how Cole positions himself within rap. But yeah, some inventive flows, decent lyricism, and isn't it just nice to hear from Cole? But anyway, let's move on to the next track. It's called Amari, and it's probably one I'm most excited about in that it's got production credits that include Timbaland. So yeah, let's get into it.
Hey, plotting my escape, this game, riding niggas fake, got a couple M's hiding in the safe, man, people being crumpy, made it out, it gotta mean something.
Already you can hear Timbaland's touch on that beat with those obviously incredibly heavy drums, which he's known for, but also those almost West Indian or Asian sitars in the background that Timbaland has used so much throughout his work, often with, you know, Justin Timberlake. And here you can hear Cole again using more of a modern flow, that slight touch of auto-tune under his vocals, which he's taken to using recently, which I think, surprisingly, actually really does suit his vocal tone, and he's sort of rolling and slurring his words together here. So yeah, let's listen to what he's saying.
Pow, pow, nigga, he's slumpy. 12 coming, we ain't seen nothing. Time chain, niggas ain't rumbling no more. Now I work for 100 for more. I never fall out with the bro. Hey, when your family turning to foe, we had a penthouse on the road.
From what I can tell, when I listened to that track, it was definitely, you know, narrating a kind of come up from Cole, from moving from North Carolina to the position that he is now, including, I think, a reference to his kid as well. It's so refreshing as well that, you know, someone like J. Cole, who has two kids, we don't hear about any of that on social media, in the media, and it's just incredible to me that he manages to keep his private life private. But yeah, probably the line that stood out to me, probably just the repeated refrain at the end, where it said, made it out, it's got to mean something. And Cole's ambition, his dedication to being remembered, is something that's been a through line throughout his whole career, and I guess how the parallels between being an athlete and being a rapper kind of come together as well. He's all about legacy, and always has been, I think. I will say that that track picked up for me when Cole's delivery changed towards, I guess, the middle portion of the track, where he became more impassioned, was almost singing. I felt like he was much more in sync with the beat at that point. First half of the track maybe was a little bit offbeat for me, but I will say, as much as I think that the first two tracks have been good, they have kind of fallen into that category that I mentioned before we started, which is to me, they feel slightly less about the songs themselves and more about a showcase of skill, and a showcase of the technical side of rap, Which, you know, is okay. Just not particularly what I go to Cole for or what I look forward to from Cole. And you know, I could have missed something in that song that was maybe a little bit more personal. And there were touches and flashes in, like I said, references to his family. But on the whole, it does seem to be a focus on technical rapping. But yeah, let's carry on. Let's see if that changes on the next track, which is called My Life.
Yeah, top of the morning. I know that you thought I was doomed. Well, the brolly for shots that was swarming. I'm black from the outside. The cops in the orbit. Nigga, I'm starving immensely. Know when I'm done with these songs, you gon' miss me. John Moran, I'm on my grizzly. You niggas just cuz me. My family tree got a history of users that struggle with demons. Not really the hustler instincts. That I see in the sky, the villains are silly. Can't reach up too evidently. Nah, shit. I can't reach up too evidently.
My life is all I have. My rhymes, my pen.
I think that's Maury. Getting hidden features, eh?
Cause where I come from, so often we build my world, my life, my life.
Say what? The stuff that I seen got me traumatized.
21.
I can't go when Johnny died. I promise you it ain't no checking me. God. Jump in the water, get wet with me. 21. You I see chicken, you niggas is breasting me.
Solid, I would say. Again, I think J. Cole's delivery was fantastic. There were some really, really great turns of phrase in Cole's verse. A little bit of insight into Cole growing up with a family who suffered with, you know, substance abuse and growing up just less than privileged and seeing the effects of that on family and friends. 21, again, is perfectly placed to provide another sort of counterbalance to that argument, having grown up in Atlanta. And the same with Moray, really. Of course, Moray being one of the breakout stars, I guess, of 2020 with his track Quicksand and his most recent album. I thought it was a solid hook, maybe not a particularly outstanding one or one of Moray's best. There's obviously great chemistry between Cole and 21, again, surprisingly, but of course, we saw it on a lot. And now here. It might have been the strongest track, one in one with the most bounce, the most urgency, which is something that I always think Cole really needs to have in his music, in that sometimes his music can be a little bit sleepy. But so far, I don't think you can say that about the off-season. I am, honestly, at this point, waiting for something to wow me from this Cole album. I really don't want this record to come and go in the same way that I kind of felt like KOD did, especially when Cole has all the talent in the world. And that's not me expecting, you know, Friday Night Lights or Forest Hills Drive. I understand, you know, artists grow, things change. But I just, I'm looking for something fresh, I think, from Cole. Decent production from Cole and T-Minus on that track, by the way. But yeah, let's move on to the next track. It's called Applying Pressure.
Yeah, nigga. Applying pressure, starting my crime with crime festers. And I ain't showing like they in they second trimesters. Ain't nothing wrong with living check to check, cause most have to. Instead of capping, why don't you talk about being a broke rapper? That's a perspective I respect, because it's real. What is big boss, let's Rick Ross, more like a wavy hideo. Kojima, they tote steamers round the way we tippy toe. Cold-blooded killers, no reptiles, just projectiles. For niggas talk to you, rocking the fresh and textiles.
This beat sounds like a slowed down version of Fire Squad. But yeah, again, loving the passion from Cole. Again, I think maybe somewhat repetitively talking about the state of the rap game and other rappers. But again, the sort of intricacy of his rhymes and the internal rhymes, I think is something he's really improved on, and you can really hear it on this.
Money ain't everything, I never say that. But niggas throw stones knowing they sell their soul to get wherever they at.
So we're on track 4 now. And I think what I was worried about, as I said at the start of this this review, this reaction, is that I was worried that some of the content of this album would be surface level, and so far I think that has proved true. It is so far lacking the sort of emotional window into Cole's real mentality. There seems to be an overriding obsession, I think, with getting his respect as a rapper, of Cole's skill level. And as I said as well, I personally think that was very much not in question. You know, over the years, Cole has had some quite silly bars, for some reason having an obsession with talking about shit sometimes. But he's also, for me, been able to touch on things in real depth. From an everyman's perspective, looking at both sides of an argument, showcasing a duality that is embedded in all elements of his music. And so far, despite the last 4 tracks being what I'd say is good. And you know, a showcase of skill. So far, I think they're coming off a little bit one-dimensional, and that's not in terms of his variety. It's just in terms of, you know, he's rapping well, but not really saying too much, in my opinion. So far, anyway, doesn't really help as well. I think that all of these tracks are quite short, so it doesn't really give you much chance to get into them, or Cole to get into too much depth about things. And you know, rapping well works perfectly on features, but on a full body of work, I personally, as a listener, need a little bit more depth. But yeah, let's move on to the next track. It's called Punching the Clock.
On top, punching the clock, clutching sanity. I got more cribs than Habitat for Humanity. Shit profound, we propagating more profanity. Peasant was a clock, this nigga ahead of me.
Here we
I
go.
The trees, barely strong enough to squeeze.
This is what we want.
Through leaves and probably kill somebody randomly.
This is what I was looking for. Cole is such a good storyteller. And so far, we haven't really got a glimpse of that. But on this track, he's diving into it, thank God.
Now pack, smoke through the cracks, I catch a contact, triggering a paranoid mindset. Now I'm back, and I'm rich, I feel nobody understanding me. All I can do is cut the mic on, holla at you. Can't let the fame scare me off for speaking candidly. Cocaine, they started singing like Danity. Now I'm left here, paid like I plan to be, damn.
That Cole verse might be potentially my favourite on the record so far. Obviously, it plays very much into the thesis of the off-season being that time where you put in the hours to really improve your craft. In this case, for J. Cole, rapping. But also, as I said, I think it just, again, touched on J. Cole's ability as a storyteller, which is also, again, one of the main things that I think is his real strength as a writer. And it's something that I think he has in common with all the big three, really, with Drake and with Kendrick Lamar. All three of them are great storytellers, which you need to be to be a great rapper. Again, that felt a little bit like an interlude in the fact that it was, you know, less than 2 minutes long. It is kind of frustrating that these tracks are quite short. I feel like we're not really getting to the root of each of these songs yet. But potentially, I think that this album might be best viewed as a whole, rather than each individual track. So with that being said, let's move on to the next one. It's called 100 Mil.
Never pet a rat, never said a lot. One of you say you on red. Don't push me, nigga, my feet on the ledge. This game is like follow the leader. If you looking completed for fighting my demons head up. When I get defeated, believe I get up. I come from a city, more niggas ain't heard of.
Not gonna lie, he sounds exactly like Lil Baby on this. Definitely sounds like a Lil Baby flow. And like in the production though, it's again similar in vibe to the tracks that we got, you know, preceding this album, like Lion King on Ice and The Climb Back, which are on this. It's got that, you know, almost southern bounce, and which I think is coming from T-Minus actually, but also these sort of really ghostly faded samples in the background, which I think pretty much works for Cole, and it's pretty different to the almost on-the-nose sampling that Cole did in the early parts of his career. But as I said, the similarity to Lil Baby's flow is a little bit jarring on this one.
She makes this when you see how it's been mine. Burst through the ceiling, I'm feeling so blind. I go in the game into his prime. Still getting better after all this time. These niggas say that they kill it, they lying.
Is that my boy James Fauntleroy? Unsung hero of rappers, man. Good track. Definitely embracing the success that Cole has and the place that he's at in his life. And again, although I enjoyed that track, especially the James Fauntleroy vocals at the end. I think perhaps what's missing from this track is, from this album so far for me, is it lacks a level of angst or of pain that Cole has often expressed in some of my favourite of his songs. And you know, I can't be mad at a guy for being happy and for enjoying his success. But that has definitely come across, that Cole is so successful now that, you know, potentially all he really has to rap about with any kind of vigour is how good he is, and rapping about rap, which for me is a slippery slope as an artist. But yeah, let's move on to the next track. I did enjoy 100 Mil, and I've enjoyed this album a lot more than I think is maybe coming across. But yeah, the next track is called Pride Is The Devil.
Pride is the devil. You left so many R.I.P.
pride is the devil. Terrified, paranoid, I put you over everything to fill the void. And when you're gone, will I have it? Yeah. Bright lights pass me in the city, it's emergency. I'm thankful because I made it past my 30s, no one murdered me.
This is already miles better than some of the previous tracks. I can see that this track is much longer than some of the previous tracks as well, so it feels a lot more fully formed, a lot more fleshed out, and it's going to give Cole the opportunity to go into depth. Interesting that he mentioned about pride, that the hook is and the title of this song is Pride is the Devil, and it seems as though his obsession with pride, his obsession with respect have been a big theme throughout this album, and perhaps the motivator behind elevating his craft during an off-season. There's also a preoccupation with death, which is again something that any kind of successful person, I think, probably does have an obsession with what they'll leave behind, an obsession with legacy, and it's something that, you know, Drake has touched on many times throughout his career, Kendrick too, and now Cole.
I had the pain of growing up in hell and poverty, trying to make a nigga feel a way that you would follow me, realizing what the rule of my problem be. It got me feeling different when somebody said he proud of me.
Some of that pain I mentioned coming through.
Yeah.
Oh. What a transition. How funny that I mentioned about the on the previous track, the similarities between the two, and then seamless transition, handoff to another, to a Lil Baby verse where you can tell he's gonna kill this. I'm loving this beat as well. Really spooky, really simple. And just works in conveying the pain of Cole's hook and Cole's verse. And now I expect Lil Baby.
All my pride gone, had to lose it all, and I got rich. I own 5 homes. Now some of this shit starting to make sense. I'm sneaking to promethazine, it's crazy, I know it. How much money coming in, it drive me crazy, not to show it.
Easily my favourite song so far. I think answered all of the previous criticisms that I had before. It had a little bit of bounce, a little bit of urgency, but also conveyed, as I said, the pain that Cole often exposes in his tracks. Great flows, great lyrics, some really great lines in there, and a fantastic appearance from Lil Baby. As I said, the handoff, the seamless handoff between those two was great. And I can hear a lot of Lil Baby influence on much of what J. Cole's doing, especially the track The Bigger Picture, one of Lil Baby's most impactful and in my opinion, best songs. It touches on a lot of topics that, in a way, that is both easy to listen to, but also pretty profound. And I think it's something that Cole definitely took on board after hearing that song and has really incorporated it into a lot of his recent music. Yeah, I'm so glad that track was a little bit longer, a little bit much more fleshed out than some of the more previous sort of braggadocious records. And it felt like both of them were rapping less about rap and more about themselves, more about their mindset, more about responsibility, and of course, about pride and how that's affected both their lives and others. Let's move on to the next track, one of the longest tracks on the album, so again, I'm hoping for something a bit more in-depth, called Let Go By Hand.
Sometimes I question whether this shit matters, putting substance into something in the world, so used to instant gratification. And just when did I become my biggest critic? I want to be my biggest fan, like today my son said that, let go my hand, reminding me one day he's gonna be his own man, and I gotta make sure he not no bitch, cause niggas bound to try him. If I said I would...
This is it, this is what I've wanted the entire album, just... storytelling Cole, talking about his life, talking about his family, talking about his son. And you know, I enjoy a flex track as much as the next man, especially if, you know, Cole is featuring on someone else's track, but this is what we go to Cole for. A soulful beat and a soulful poet. And I think that's what he displayed on the last track and is now displaying on this one.
Trying to expose me for a fraud, and with my reputation at stake, I was scuffling just to save face. My last scrap was with Puff Daddy, who would have thought it? I bought that nigga album in 7th grade and played it so much, and innocence is just ignorance before it's introduced to currency eclipse.
I'm a big fan of this track. It's taken to the middle of the album, or the second half of the album, I guess, but this is the Cole that I love, you know, talking about, again, you know, kind of following on and following on from, I guess, probably the themes of this album so far anyway, are respect and pride and talking about the brawl that he had with P. Diddy or Puff Daddy, and how ironic it is that he grew up looking up to this guy and ended up having a scuffle with him over pride. And it's interesting that Cole seems to have let go of that, or is trying at least through this album to try and let go of that pride in order to equip his son. And again, I guess that shows the impact of having a child or having kids has on a man. Is that James again? In fact, that sounds like Baz. Oh, I'm liking that. He's actually got Diddy on it as well. Another fantastic track. Last three have been really, really great actually. I love that he got Diddy on the end of that track to sort of show Cole's growth as a person, that he's, you know, not holding any grudges, or, you know, there's no sort of residual energy between he and Diddy. But also that appearance from Baz or Bars, however you want to say it, with an English accent, I think it just sounds weird. But I've heard, I used to listen to a lot of his early music when he first signed to Dreamville, but I've never heard him sing in that kind of way. In a way that reminded me of James Fauntleroy. But another fantastic track that really expounds on, I think, the themes of this album that are becoming more and more apparent, the duality, of, as always with Cole, of pride, responsibility, and respect. I also love the exploration of religion as well, something that I don't think Cole has talked too much about throughout his career. He's always come across, I think, as a Christian, but he's talked about exploration of Islam. There, which, you know, quite fitting, I guess, just before Ramadan. Next track is a track that he released previously called Interlude, which now in hindsight gives a real insight into the sound of the album, so you can see why he released it previously. And it's followed by The Climb Back, of course, a track that was released a while ago. And you can actually see my initial reaction to this, along with Lion King on Ice, a few videos back, so when it first came out. There'll be a link to that full reaction in the description box below, but I am gonna listen to both Interlude and The Climb Back again, you know, just in context of the album. Again, just a touch of autotune, really works.
This shit can go one of two ways. Your brother, the blood leaks while the EMTs gotta carry her baby like Sarah. Your mother's found with a terrorist. Some of those traumatized wouldn't trade it for nothing through hard times. It was there I discovered her. In age 33, and so did Pimp-C, and so did Nipsey.
Love that beat, love that track. Again, another one though that I really wish was fleshed out, but despite that, I think the instrumental is fantastic on that, and Cole's flow, top notch. Yeah, next track is The Climb Back. Of course, heard it a while ago. Another good track, let's hear it again.
Everything come back around full circle. Why do lies sound pleasant but the truth hurtful? But how long will it take for you smile? This is that come back to life shit. Might paint the town red for my nigga found dead too soon. Trash rappers, ass backers, trying to go toe-to-toe, we laugh at ya. Staff strapped up on top the totem pole to blast at ya. Bassmasters, are they going for show? Blow your clothes half off like a promo code.
Looking back on it now, The Climb Back definitely fits the vibe of this album really, really well. You can tell, of course, you know, they were recorded in a similar period of time, and again follows on from the similar kind of themes that are explored on earlier tracks. But as I said, if you really do want to see my initial reaction and my initial thoughts to The Climb Back, yeah, do check out the video in the description box. We're on to the final two tracks, which I can't believe, as I said, this album has flown by in a good way though. It feels very succinct and very to the point, which is something I really appreciate in, you know, the 25, 30 song streaming era. But next track is called Close or Close. We'll see within the song.
Close.
Close. Recognize the song.
One, two, one, close. I stare at my dreams as they approach. Gotta be patient and trust in God, he the coach. Gone are the days we was close. Now when I see you, I look at you just like a ghost. A shell of your former self, so caught up with that dope. You was a good nigga, we knew each other's folks. Now you gotta ride around with a toast and you keep that shit close.
Again, another sort of fantastic example of Cole the storyteller and Cole touching on more personal subjects. Second half of this album has really not necessarily blown me away, but really addressed all of the criticism that I labelled at the first half, that it felt very surface level. Here talking about a friend, clearly has been going through a bad time, and Cole again trying to offer some kind of sage advice. He's done this in the past on other types of songs, trying to, you know, put himself in other people's shoes. As I said, he's a man of the people, and it can sometimes come across as sanctimonious, but I get where Cole's coming from in a lot of scenarios. I think he's doing it very well on this. Again, sort of intricate rhymes, hanging on every word type of writing.
But nothing came out of my throat, niggas cocked back the hammers and you froze. In your eyes I saw hope, moment I wish we were still close. Maybe I could have saved you, but no, trigger squeeze, gun smoke. I opened up my eyes with a joke, reached for my phone, missed calls and a text message note from my mama saying you just got smoked. Damn, this life is no joke. Close.
That's so sad, man. An emotional song that, as you realise throughout the song, and as you realise at the end, that he's not just talking about a friend that he lost touch with, but actually someone that he lost, someone that potentially that he lost touch with, and then also lost their life back in his hometown. You can now hear, again, as I said before, the passion and the pain in Cole's delivery in a different type of way. Really sad song. One that actually, out of surprise, just by the ending, I didn't see that coming, to be fair, and felt touched emotionally by that as well. Again though, you know, objectively, another really, really solid track. Like I said, the second half of this album has been really fantastic, and I can't believe that we're on the final track, Hunger on Hillside, and I really am excited to see how he closes out this album. I know that both the intro and the outro both were produced by Boy Wonder. I think production across the whole album really has been pretty strong, pretty consistent. Heavy drums and really faintly used samples. Let's hear the final track and then, you know, I'll give you my final initial thoughts.
Sick on your heart, keep your head strong. If I quit now, then I'm dead wrong. Fighting off this hunger for hours. Whole world know my name, bitch, my rep strong. We sold out in less than an hour.
This beat is
these words I still sing like I'm slept on. I wanna know if they understand me. I put it all on A, ain't no plan B. Fun around, got gray hairs already.
He's absolutely mastered a different type of sing-songy flow. It's so impactful, it's so moving, and I think in combination with this really, really soulful, old school, almost jazzy beat, it's really fantastic. This obviously feels like an epic outro. Shout out to Boy Wonder again on the production. This is the kind of introspective, you know, self-analyzing Cole that I love, and it seems as though he saved the best till last.
Make a few $1,000 stack with every hour pass. I catch you playing inside my lane and I'ma foul your ass. I'm feeling myself, I'm bitter, my wealth up till it's towering.
Good God.
Put my tongue all in my bitch, she keep that hollering. Till you realize that you is the hoe. Shit gon' get hard, keep your head strong.
God damn, this guy's right.
If I quit now, then I'm dead wrong.
James Fauntleroy, again, you know. Golden touch, this man. Great closer, really great closer. To what turned out to be a really good album, actually. First, I'd say 4 or 5 tracks for me. It wasn't enough depth, but God, did he make it up in the second half. The second half of this album, very, very strong. And I think, you know, now having listened to it all the way through, the strength of the second half will really make any sort of re-listens a lot better, knowing that, you know, the first few tracks are focused on flexing, on respect, and then as the album goes on, it gets deeper, then focuses on, you know, responsibility, legacy, and just how you're going to be remembered. And I think that final track does a really good job of exploring the idea of how can you remain the same person after having gone through this journey? How can you retain your own sense of identity, your own sense of self at the end of a journey of being so successful? And I guess leading Cole towards, you know, inevitable retirement after the fall off, after another project, I think, called It's a Boy. He has kind of mapped it out in that way. But I think overall, as I said just before that final track, this has been a really consistent, really cohesive album, really consistent in terms of production. There are some loose themes in there, especially that come to the fore towards the end. Again, as I keep repeating myself, J. Cole touching upon the duality of lots of different subjects and addressing them well. showcasing really well the improvement in his own technical skill in terms of flow, cadence, rhymes, and it has definitely been a massive improvement. And I think if I were to, you know, on a first listen, try and position this project somewhere within sort of the echelons of Cole music, I'd say, you know, I think Friday Night Lights is kind of an untouchable marriage of, you know, that early sort of not quite famous yet hunger and somebody who just got so much to say. For me, it probably goes Friday Night Lights, Forest Hills Drive. And then third spot is probably up for grabs. I like to say the Truly Yours collection of EPs would probably go there, but if we're going bodies of work, I think potentially The Off-Season may be Cole's, you know, third best work, just on that first listen anyway. I am really looking forward to re-listening to this album on headphones pretty much straight after this. But yeah, overall, a really fantastic experience. Great to hear new music from one of the most impactful and most important artists, I'd say, of this generation of hip-hop. And hopefully it signals the arrival of Drake, the arrival of Kendrick, so we can actually see where all three of these guys are at this point in their careers. I'd say probably my favourite tracks were all of the second half. I can't really pick out any in particular because they were all really, really strong, even including The Climb Back and Interlude. But I'd say, you know, the outro, Hunger on Hillside, Close, a really, really moving song actually, Let Go and Pride is the Devil. It's going to be hard to beat that portion of the album, I think, from anybody who's releasing over the next 12 months really. But yeah, all that said though, I really am interested to hear what everybody else thought this album. Did you enjoy the first half or the second half more? What did you think of it overall? And what are your favourite tracks? Please do leave me a comment and let me know what you thought of this Cole album and where it sits for you, I guess, amongst Cole's projects. That being said though, please, if you've enjoyed this reaction, if you've enjoyed my thoughts, please do remember to subscribe to this channel, like the video, and follow me on all the social links below. I am going to be trying to upload a lot more consistently now, as it seems as though this Cole album will probably signal the speeding up of the music industry and the release of projects. So until the next one, please do stay safe, stay well, and I'll see you next time.